I invite you to rise as we welcome the United States Army Honor Guard from Fort Huachuca.
Prepare to unfold. Unfold. Then, on behalf of the President of the United States Army, and a grateful nation, please accept this flag as a symbol of our appreciation for your loved ones' honorable and faithful service. Will you please hold out your hand? These three rounds represent beauty, honor, country.
The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to the faithful. For the Lord knows our frame and remembers that we are dust. The steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon the faithful, and the righteousness of the Lord to children's children. Friends, we have gathered here today to praise God and to listen to our faith as we celebrate the life of Roy Ludlow. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace, acknowledging our human loss, that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow hope, and in death resurrection. I invite you to stand as you are able as we sing, Be Thou My Vision.
Please join me in prayer. Eternal God, we praise you for the great company of all those who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labor. We praise you for those dear to us whom we name in our hearts before you. Especially we praise you for Roy, whom you have graciously received into your presence. To all of these, grant your peace. Let perpetual light shine upon them, and help us so to believe where we have not seen, that your presence may lead us through our years and bring us at last with them into the joy of your home, not made with hands, but eternal in the heavens, Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. We join our voices in reading together Psalm 23, finding comfort and encouragement as surely Loy did throughout his life of faith. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. Yea, though I walk through righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
There are three individuals who made me the man I am today. My Heavenly Father, Jesus Christ, my earthly father, Max Green, and my father-in-law, Roy Ludlow. These three men continue to be my heroes today. Roy asked me to read the following passage. Romans 8, 35 through 39. Who shall separate us from the one of Christ, the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all of these things, we are more the consequences through him who loves us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the presence nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Him and have seen him. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. Jesus answered, Don't you know me, Philip, even after I have been among you such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am the Father and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you are not just my own, rather it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or at least believe on the evidence of the miracles themselves. I tell you the truth, may one who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do it even greater because I am going to the Father, and I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will grant it.
Take my hand, precious Lord.
Thank you, choir. Roy loved you. And I can hear him singing with you now. Is this the Reverend Dr. Candace Lansbury? This is the Reverend Dr. Roy Ludlow. Welcome to Desert Skies. Just about every conversation I ever had with the Reverend Dr. Roy began with that conversation and interchange. He was a colleague, a friend, an encourager, and a co-worker here at Desert Skies. His ordination and his education and mine were important to him because it encompassed both his passion for serving God and for ongoing learning. It reminded him and all of us, as Paul said in his writing to the Romans, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. That nothing, I'm going to repeat that, nothing will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. And he lived his life believing that with all of his heart. And that touched every single one of us sitting in the room today. His spirit, his infectious sense of humor, his delight in anything that any of us were doing that was moving the kingdom forward. You just knew that Reverend Dr. Roy was there rooting for you, praying for you, and hoping for your success. Roy Wilbur Ludlow was born on January 12th, 1936, to Marion and Edna Ludlow in Portland, Oregon. I mean, who is born in Portland, Oregon, that ends up here in Tucson, Arizona? But I am so grateful, Terry, for the beautiful words that you put together that I'm going to share right now, a sort of recap of some of the highlights of Roy's life. This family of seven moved to Hillsboro, Oregon, when Roy was around the age of four or five. He is number four of five children. He was baptized around that age at the Hillsboro Methodist Church, and he remembers, I love this, the water being so cold as it ran down his neck. Isn't that memory just so Roy? He attended public school through high school and then Portland State College, where he started, anyone have a guess? As an engineering major. Quickly, he realized that was not his life calling. He was subsequently drafted into the Army, served 2 years as an enlisted soldier, and after those 2 years of service, returned to Portland State College, where he earned his degree in psychology in May of 1961. And it was at that point of his, I think this is great, right? He's getting a degree in psychology. He's learning how all that stuff works. And then he met and married the love of his life, Betty Bloy, in March of 1961. He then accepted a job with the Oregon State Employment Service in Portland, but was soon transferred to Oregon City. And once they were settled there, he and Betty started their family. Shortly after the birth of their first child, Terry, in August of 1962, Roy and Betty moved to Madison, New Jersey. Anyone but me know it's in Madison, New Jersey? His experience as a camp counselor in his early years influenced his decision to pursue working in the ministry, and he chose Drew University. Go, Drew! Another thing that we had in common, due to recommendations of a number of clergy that he knew back in Oregon. And while attending Drew University, Roy served in his first clergy position at Broadway Methodist Church in Broadway, New Jersey, as a student minister. And during that time, their son Mark was born in 1965. Following seminary, Roy moved his family back to Oregon, where he served as minister at the Rainier Methodist Church and Garden Home Methodist Church. And after serving at Garden Home Methodist Church, Roy went back into the military and served as an Army chaplain for 18 years. And besides serving as a chaplain in Vietnam, His career choice allowed the family to the opportunity to live in multiple places, including Washington, California, Germany, New Jersey, Arizona, and Alaska. And many of you know him from some of those different places, or you share stories about those common destinations. While he was in California, Roy attended Azusa Pacific University, where he earned his master's degree in marriage, family, and child counseling. And while in Germany, Roy earned an educational specialist EDS degree from Ball State University. Did I mention that Roy loved learning? Roy and Betty chose to return to Tucson, Arizona, as their final place of residence in July of 1988. And after returning to Arizona, upon his retirement from the military, Roy served as an Arizona prison chaplain for 11 years. In May 2010, Roy earned his doctorate in biblical studies with an emphasis in biblical counseling from Masters International University and officially became the Reverend Dr. Roy. And he provided much needed counseling services for Desert Skies United Methodist Church, which he was still doing when I came here in 2015. After retiring from prison service, Roy served as an on-call chaplain for Tucson Medical Center until his final retirement in 2019. The family jokes that it took Roy not one, not two, but five tries until he truly retired. And when his kids asked what his greatest accomplishment was, he would say without a hesitation, marrying your mother. Roy had many labels throughout his life: son, brother, teenager, young man, lifeguard, Christian, husband, father, minister, chaplain, grandfather, friend, mentor, and neighbor. Those are but a few of the labels that represent Roy's life. But I love Terry's words. It was with a twinkle in his eyes and a smile on his face and joy in his heart that he stated, marrying your mother was his shining accomplishment, and husband was his favorite label. Roy passed away at home, surrounded by love, on January 29th of this year. And of course, he didn't stop living life fully when he and Betty decided that hospice was his best option. No, he called me over and we planned this service together. And he continued to regale all of us with stories of his friends, his family, his ministry, his colleagues. He gifted us all with so much right up until the end. He even would join in at Christ Cafe at the end of the online worship service so that he could engage with others who were simply worshiping from home. We'll hear from Judd and Pat in a moment, two friends who have much to share and who the family have asked to represent all of you. I know that many of you, because you've told me as you walked in, have lots of stories to share as well. We'll ask you to save those for when we go over to the reception after the worship service. You'll just follow the path down and around. A lot of people will be there to show you where to go. You know, there is so much that could be said about Roy, and probably a lot that has already been said. There was the best of him. I'm guessing, though, most of us didn't see it. There was the worst of him, and maybe a lot of in between. But you know, that's not unique to or only about Roy. That's also true about you and me. There's a lot that could be said about every single one of us here today, and probably a lot that has already been said: the best, the worst, and the in between. Or as John Wesley would say, we're just a bunch of people going on to perfection. And the thing that strikes me about that, especially on days like today that we gather together because a life on earth has ended, is that God wastes absolutely nothing of our lives. Not the good, not the bad, not the indifferent. What God creates, God loves. And what God loves everlastingly. So nothing of Roy, nothing of you or me is wasted with God. Nothing. Not our joys or our sorrows, not our successes or our failures, not the times when we're on the top of the world or the times that we've lost our way. Not the best in us, not the worst in us, not the times that we were true and authentic to ourselves or the times that we betrayed ourselves or someone else, not our ups or our downs, not our sanity or our craziness. I think that's what Paul is getting at when he writes, "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing is outside or beyond the presence and love of God." Now, I don't think that's usually how we see ourselves or each other. We often take a particular story or event in our lives or our journey to perfection. Sometimes it's the good event. Sometimes it's a really bad event. Sometimes it's just the mundane indifference of our lives. But we let that become the defining characteristic of ourselves and of each other. And when we do that, we waste the fullness of our life's journey. But friends, that's not what God does. No one's life can be captured or defined by a particular moment or event. God neither edits nor wastes any part of our life. Instead, God loves us into the next sentence, paragraph, or chapter of our life story. God is always continuing the story of life. And that's the reassurance that Jesus offers Thomas in today's gospel reading, read so beautifully, Dawn, thank you. Thomas is lost and grieving and afraid. How can we know the way? He asked Jesus, and it's a question that we ask throughout our lives and especially on days like today. "Do not let your hearts be troubled," Jesus said to Thomas and to us. And then he promises presence and life. "In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places." It's as if Jesus is saying, yeah, life is challenging and it's changing, but it never ends. And isn't that what we want to know on days like today? Isn't that what we want to hear when a loved one has died? We want to know that his or her story of life continues and that we will be a part of it. So what does that mean for you and Roy? Well, take a minute and just remember, recall the ways in which your life and Roy's intersected. What are the stories of you and Roy? In what ways did he touch your life? What did he do or give for which you will always be grateful? What's the best mischief he ever got you into? What are your funniest stories about Roy? And what are your saddest stories? What were your best times with him, and what were your most difficult? What are the stories of Roy that melt your heart, that you never want to forget? And what are the stories of you and Roy that break your heart and you wish you could forget? And then, what do you do with those stories? What are they asking of you? To celebrate him? To thank him, to forgive him, to ask his forgiveness, to wish him well, to tell him what he means to you, to tell him that you love him, to bless him? What needs to happen for you to continue the story of Roy. And isn't that really what resurrection is all about? Continuing the story of your life? And isn't that our hope for this day, for Roy and for ourselves? Roy asked me to end this homily. See, I told you he planned the whole thing. With a poem by an unknown author called Remember Me. Don't remember me with sadness. Don't remember me with tears. Remember all the laughter we've shared throughout the years. Now I am contented that my life, it was worthwhile. Knowing that I passed along the way, I made someone smile. When you're walking down the street and you've got me on your mind, I'm walking in your footsteps, only half a step behind. So please don't be unhappy. I'm smiling throughout eternity. Amen. Judd, I'd invite you to come up to share.
I'm Judd McDowell. Joanne and I met Roy back in 1964. We met at a couples group at Madison Methodist Church. Madison Methodist Church happened to be directly adjacent to Drew University, where Roy was a seminary student. I had just graduated in the beginning summer of 1963 from Michigan State, and I was in a work-study program in New Jersey. And at this couples club was a group of all ages of people, couples, trying to meet other people, and the people that were most important in our lives turned out to be Roy and Betty. Roy and I, over the time, shared some of our experiences in school, both of us struggling to study. Turns out my engineering work and his theology didn't match particularly well. I think I was much more interested in the papers he was writing than he was ever interested in any of my calculus problems. But we certainly shared, we were both from the West, and we both shared our experiences of getting used to Eastern culture and trying to understand words like toynament for tournament and similar colloquial expressions that seemed to be quite foreign to us. Roy and I had really quite different curriculums, but exchanging views about education and the teachers that we had that were so positive and so informative to us was a shared experience that I will never forget. As Candace said, Roy and Betty moved to Broadway, New Jersey. And for some of you, it may be hard to imagine that there's a place in New Jersey that is really very distant and rural and small town. And Roy would share some of his stories about his experiences in this rural setting. It was there that Mark was born. And my wife and I can still vividly remember one trip we took out to visit them in Broadway, in which Betty expressed the insight that it seemed that Mark was not responding to sound very much. And I can remember all of us picking up things and banging on pots and pans to see if that stimulated Mark, and the stimulation was minimal, and subsequently she got verified that he was really significantly deaf. That change in childhood had a significant impact, I think, on Roy and Betty's life experiences and choices along life's way. In time, after I finished my education in the East, Joanne and I decided that we would move back west again, never having quite gotten used to the East. We moved to Boulder, Colorado. And when Betty and Roy finished seminary, they came back through and visited. It was a trip that was a notorious trip in their history. They were pulling a four-wheeled, very much a hay kind of trailer. And they had, I think, someplace between 7 and 8 flat tires on that trip. And but they had a brief release with us in the visit that they stayed with us in Boulder. They went on to Oregon, and as Candace has enumerated, he then served as a pastor in the Oregon Conference for a number of years. Finally, it is my sense, and I think discussion with Roy, that one of the decisions to go back in the Army was to get some additional support for the special needs of Mark. And so he joined the Army. And in short time, not too long after that, they moved to Germany. The only thing I really knew or saw afterwards of their experience that I know they enjoyed in Germany was all the Christmas decorations that Betty had accumulated. Every year she had a theme Christmas tree. And I can remember for years always admiring her theme Christmas trees. In that time, about the time they moved to Germany, we changed houses in Boulder. And we lost track of them for a number of years. And then, in IBM's due wisdom, IBM opened a company in Tucson, Arizona, and my unit got transferred here. We've been here not very long. And in the fall of 78, as I think Roy was coming back from a trip to Oregon Conference, he was riding an airplane into Tucson. And of course, as Roy would always do, he started a conversation with the seatmate next to him. And the seatmate said that he'd worked for IBM at a new site in Tucson. And Roy shared that he had known at one time a good friend who was in Boulder who worked for IBM. And when he told them who it was, the man says, well, he says, I work now in Tucson and work and live in Tucson. And Roy got off the plane, called me up on the phone, and the following weekend we were down reunited with Betty and Roy. And in the ensuing years, Betty and Roy became a very important part of our family. Roy, of course, started his work as a counselor in Florence. And in that time, I think I was impressed with Roy's conveying his message and belief in God and his ability to connect and do counseling for people in dealing with the realities of the problems that they had. His counseling skills turned out to be an area of major contribution in the years that followed. Roy was a lifelong learner, as Candace had mentioned, and eventually did earn his PhD. When Betty and Roy transferred from Fort Huachuca, Arizona, to Alaska, Roy had a small MG and wanted to keep his MG. And so he stored a small MG in my garage in Tucson. And we kept it in the garage to keep it out of the sun. Unfortunately, we didn't keep it out of the pack rats. And by the time they finally came back, after he retired, and they moved back to Tucson then. And that was the first time in all the years that we had known them that we actually lived in the same community. And that miracle of his making a contact with a person that sat beside him was such an unlikely event that I've often thought there was some kind of divine providence in that unlikely event. And that only happened because Roy's ability to engage people wherever he went in conversation and inquire about who they were, what they did, and where they came from. Roy's work, I think, as a chaplain, I think, was one of those also stunning examples in which, in the way he communicated his faith in God, he also challenged and related to the people that were in sometimes very difficult circumstances, and he was a really bright light sometimes in a very dark place. In 2000, when I retired from IBM, my wife and I decided that we were going to go back to Colorado. And so we went back to Colorado, but we kept our contact here with this community and visited probably every 2 to 3 years as we passed through from visiting our daughter in California. As we have aged and the family in Greeley slowly diminished, we decided that it was time to try and get closer to the California daughter. But California is just too busy and too expensive for us, and so we ended up splitting the difference and came back to Tucson. We still had maintained contact with any number of people in this congregation and in the Tucson in general, and this was home to us. And we have never regretted the fact that we made that decision to move back here, even though we knew that Roy's health was declining, but we were back in time to have some time to visit and exchange feelings with Roy once again. In the time that we lived together with them in Tucson the first time around, they played a very important role in our family life. Roy ended up being at least a participant in the weddings of two of our children. At least one of our children married in the Catholic faith, but Roy was participated in that wedding. And in addition, along the way, Roy baptized three of our children, none of who lived in Tucson, but always made trips to Tucson where Roy was to have the children baptized. In all that time, Roy's faith, his belief in God, his fun, his funny streaks, his funny stories, all touched my life, as I'm sure he has touched, you know, many of your lives. And I know that in the years ahead, we will all remember the way he touched our lives, and he will truly be missed. Amen.
My name is Patricia Walker, and as I was preparing these notes on the Reverend Dr. Roy Ludlow, our friend, two thoughts kept coming to me. The first was how many times I wrote, "I remember this, but I don't remember that." And the second was that I hope you will join in the reception and tell your Roy stories as well. We first met the Reverend Roy Ludlow at a choir party. Roy and wife Betty and their friends, Judd and Joanne, came together, and we could see the strength of their friendship. I don't remember much about the party, but I remember being impressed with Roy and Betty. Betty had a fine sense of humor, and Roy always told you what he thought. and I've always appreciated both of those qualities. Through the years, we enjoyed the Ludlow's 4th of July parties, often followed by a monsoon storm on our way home. There were Easter parties, New Year's Eve, and then there was the Halloween night that Betty and Roy showed up at our house dressed as Raggedy Ann and Raggedy Andy. Now, Vernon and I never get trick-or-treaters, so we don't stock up on candy. So we had nothing to give them. So Roy and Betty gave us some of their candy. There is a picture. One more thing I have to mention. For a while, Betty and I sat together in choir here at Desert Skies, two sopranos on the end of the first row, and we were not well behaved. I remember one incident when we both either sang the wrong word at the same time or the wrong note at the same time, and we both started to giggle so hard that Susan Schild, our then choir mistress, had to stop rehearsal so that we could get a hold of ourselves. I knew that as a pastor, Roy was a good listener. And at one point, I asked for Roy's personal and pastoral guidance in a thorny situation, and was rewarded with counsel that was honest, sensible, and reliable. Roy became a prison chaplain, first at the facility at Florence, and then here at the Wilmot Prison. We didn't see Roy much during that time, but when we did, he would talk about and was influenced by the philosophy called restorative justice. Years later, I learned that the Reverend Roy Ludlow was now the Reverend Dr. Roy Ludlow, and we talked about his progress through the Masters International University of Divinity and his mentor, Dr. of Philosophy Skip Moen. Dr. Moen has a blog and writes sermons and observations on scripture every day. He's fluent in Greek, Latin, Hebrew, and Aramaic. And upon Roy's advice, I followed Dr. Moen, and I learned a lot. You might want to look him up. He's really good. The Reverend Dr. Roy began to make himself available in daytime hours here at Desert Skies for personal counseling, and based on Dr. Moen's theories of biblical interpretation. And again, I sought out Roy's counsel and guidance. I laid my concerns before him. He considered. We talked. Roy could call up a scriptural verse that suited exactly what I needed to hear. Not by chapter and verse, but by an acute sense of fitness and insight. He was always himself. Pragmatic, sometimes a bit argumentative, and a wealth of professional history as a pastor and counselor. He told you what he thought and didn't try to mince words. Now, honestly, today, I cannot remember what my problem was, so it must have gotten solved. It had something to do with an iceberg, I mean, metaphorically. But I cannot now tell you what I was concerned about. Roy, being with Roy, solved the problem. What I do remember are the scriptural discussions we had, because again, Roy's focus was on what the Bible can teach us about life and problem solving in this mortal earth. We talked about the virgin birth, pro and con. He asked me if I believed in Satan as a reality, and when I said no, he said, "You might want to rethink that." Occasionally, I might say, "I wouldn't believe that in a million years." And he might say, "Well, that's still probably true, even if it didn't happen exactly that way." One of the most chewed on bones for Roy was a phrase we often speak during communion. When offering the bread, we might say, "The body of Christ broken for you." Roy would come unglued, reminding me that nothing in scripture supports body broken for you. He would bristle and say, "Scripture plainly says none of his bones were broken." Now, thankfully, here at Desert Skies, we ordinary folk have the honor of offering communion elements to our parishioners alongside the pastors. And it was my turn to serve communion that Sunday, so here I am. I am holding the bread, and I see Roy coming toward me up the aisle. So I broke off a piece of bread, I put it into his cupped hands, I looked at him and I said, "Roy, this is the body of Christ given for you." And he, this little smile crossed his face, and he moved on. But I knew what he was thinking, and he knew what I was thinking. Roy became a hospital chaplain and was often at Tucson Medical Center and the hospice center at Pepe's house. Roy visited my dad at Pepe's house when my dad was dying, and Roy would call frequently to give me a timetable of when he could be with Dad, and or what had happened when he had been there. He was able to give me advice about what to say in those last moments. "I love you. I forgive you. Forgive me. Thank you for being in my life." Roy would take on anything. Several years ago, I was asked to write a scene featuring the prophet Simeon, the man in the Gospel of Luke who awaits the consolation of Israel and finds it and finds the Messiah in the baby Jesus. This was to be presented at a blue Christmas service, much as was featured this past year at Desert Skies. I modeled the look and manner of Simeon on Roy Ludlow. Tall, spare, old enough to be frustrated by having to wait so long, forthright, and not too bothered by what other people might think. The name Simeon in Hebrew means "he who hears." I asked Roy to read the part, and of course he nailed it the first time. And of course then he had a few suggestions. Roy insisted on taking his shoes off for the role because he felt that Simeon would know he was standing on holy ground. I thought Roy was getting a little too much into the role, as it was winter and cold, and we finished the service on the bare tile in the narthex. Roy never flinched. He was standing on holy ground. Betty, he is standing on holy ground.
Let us pray. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you still are God. We pray to you for one another in our need and for all anywhere who mourn with us this day. To those who doubt, give light. To those who are weak, strength. To all who have sinned, mercy. To all who sorrow, your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. In all our ways, we trust you. O God, all that you have given us is yours. As first you gave Roy to us, now we give Roy back to you. Receive Roy into the arms of your mercy. Raise Roy up with all your people. Receive us also and raise us into a new life. Help us so to love and serve you in this world, that we may enter into your joy in the world to come.
God of love, we thank you for all with which you have blessed us even to this day, for the gift of joy in days of health and strength, and for the gifts of your abiding presence and promise in days of pain and grief. We praise you for home and friends, and for our baptism and place in your church with all who have faithfully lived and died. Above all, we thank you for Jesus, who knew our griefs, who died our death and rose for our sake, and who lives and prays for us. And as he taught us, so now we pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you to stand as we sing the final song that Roy chose for us today, O Love That Will Not Let Me Go. Please stand. And now may the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, according to the riches of God's glory, grant you to be strengthened with might through God's Spirit in your innermost being, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ, which surpasses all knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Amen. We invite you to head on over to the fellowship hall where the family will be there to greet you. So I will lead them, Reverend Susan and I will lead them out so that we don't just all hang out here. We'll head over to the fellowship hall where we can greet and share stories together.